गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, गुड इवनिंग, नमस्कार. दिस इज माय नेम, दिस इज द ईमेल एड्रेस, दिस इज द नेम ऑफ द टेलीग्राम चैनल, दिस इज द वेबसाइट एंड दिस इज द डिस्काउंट कोड. आई एम फीलिंग बेटर नाउ. आई हैव आल्सो बीन आस्क्ड टू इन्फॉर्म यू दैट इफ यू टेक अ सब्सक्रिप्शन यूजिंग अ रेफरल कोड, विच एवर वन, प्रेफरेबली दिस वन फॉर दोज ऑफ यू हु नीड इट. You will also be now given study material from an academy as well in printed form so that you can access them because it's important. Okay, we are in the final edition of the Magna Carta 2021 and we will continue from here on. Okay, chaliye, we now start with judiciary. Judiciary is often one of the most, right? Yes, Akansha, thank you for reminding us. If you hadn't, I would have forgotten about it. Anyways, let's continue. Judiciary is one of the most overdone topics for this exam because everybody who teaches polity becomes a constitutional lawyer. Everybody who studies polity becomes or teaches polity becomes a constitutional lawyer and wants to impart every possible iota of information there is on the judicial system of this country. Unfortunately, the prelims doesn't work that way. So let's quickly understand how this entire ecosystem works and what is the larger discussion around it. Now, we use something called the I square adjective for the judiciary, which means it is independent and it is integrated. Now, you must understand the meanings of both of these and you must understand the implications of both of these. This is actually fairly important for the prelims exam. Yes, Vipin. So let's look at it. When we say that the judiciary is an independent agency, what does that mean? Independent from whom? And what are the kinds of independence? So, is judiciary absolutely independent? No. But it is relatively more independent than the other two branches of government from each other. If you look at the LENJ distribution, between the three of it, judiciary is your original loner, right? Like to stay away. They don't like to mingle with the masses. They're cool people. They like to sit in a corner. You know those parties, those gatherings that you go to, and there'll be this one dude in this party who will be in a party with music and headphones on, right? That person. That person who'll come to a DJ party with a pair of headphones on. That is the judiciary, right? It is independent, but it is not absolutely independent. Clear? Which means it is relatively more independent in terms of appointment, in terms of removal, in terms of functions. Let us not forget that at the end of the day, the real democratic mandate lies with the elected house of the country, which means to a very large extent, the parliament or the president through the council of ministers can exercise a certain amount of supervision over the judiciary. Okay, good. So this is what is meant in terms of an independent judiciary. What does the word integrated mean? Simply put, unlike the legislature and the executive, where the state legislatures and the state executives are completely disjointed from the central legislatures and the central executive. To put it in a funny way, if the state legislatures are not able to pass a bill, the bill does not go on appeal to the parliament. That's not how it works. I remember somebody very, very learned had asked me this question. that, sir, if the state legislatures are not able to pass a bill, does the bill go on appeal to the parliament? And the world around me has never been the same ever since. And that's the larger explanation. What we're essentially trying to say is, unlike the legislatures and the executive, wherein they're completely disjointed from each other, their areas of domain, their areas of operation, their areas of administration, their areas of legislation have been clearly and categorically defined and identified away from one another. Judiciary doesn't work like that. Judiciary, right from the lowest to the highest court, is connected with a single dotted line. Simply means that you could go from bottom to top, and you could go from top to bottom. How does this work? From bottom to top, you have something called an appeal. You can go from a lower court to a higher court. And from top to bottom basically means that the judgments given by the higher courts of the country are always binding on the lower courts of the country. Right? Now, why does India choose to be an independent and an integrated judiciary? The answers are fairly simple. The first and the most important is, if India has chosen to have a written constitution, a codified single piece of law that governs the government, and if India has chosen to be a federal constitution in the sense that there is a union and a state government, you've got to put this in writing. Think of the judiciary as a rent agreement you would have between you and your landlord or your landlady. Your house owner is like the center. You are the state. Your house owner can supervise and can bully you as much as they'd like. But to put certain checks to safeguard your rights, you have what is called a rent agreement. A rent agreement protects you. And the rent agreement is written in an unbiased manner. That's essentially what a judiciary is supposed to do. So think of it this way. When we had the independence after party on 26th January 1950, when the constitution was also put into force post-independence, the states, towards the end of the party, they were introduced to the governor. They were introduced to All India Services. They were really, really upset. They were in a very bad space because they knew that the center could, really take the cake away from them. The only way the states could be given a sort of assurance was the fact that there is going to be a judiciary which is going to be independent from the other branches of government and would, in an unbiased manner, adjudicate on decisions and laws that have to be implemented in this country. This is essentially how the concept and the origin of judiciary sort of came about. This is why we are an independent judiciary. This is why we're an integrated judiciary. Right? An independent and an integrated judiciary is essential for a federal constitution or a federal country. If you don't have an independent judiciary, you cannot have a functional and a transparent federal country. A federal country is that which has both the center and the state governments. So that's the larger discussion. Now, it's also very important for you to understand certain words and certain phrases that are often discussed. The first is, of course, the hierarchy of it all, right? We've often heard of center, state, and local. Now, when we look at center, state, and local from a judicial perspective, and we go from top to bottom, you have the Supreme Court, you have the High Court, and then at the district level, you have the district court. Now, please pay absolute attention and listen to my words as they are the gospel from the Prime Minister of this country, because what he says is the gospel of truth. Under no circumstances whatsoever will you study the organization of formal courts below the district, which means under no circumstances will you study the organization of formal courts below the district, which means I hear a lot of people asking me, sir, what is a magistrate's court? Sir, what is a munsif court? So what is a Mamsabdari God? Now here is the problem. I'll be very happy to explain all of that to you. The only issue is it's entirely irrelevant as far as the prelims exam is concerned. Now you must understand why. You must understand why. Because the organization of these courts vary from state to state. The organization of these lower courts vary from state to state. And you cannot be asked a question contingent to one state or defined to one state because it may not be true in the other. States with lesser populations, lesser administrative infrastructure, lesser resources in the judiciary will not have an elaborate lower judicial system. So you cannot ask an unnecessarily comprehensive question on judiciary as far as that is concerned. So are we clear on that? Good. Excellent. Now, I said you don't need to know about formal courts, but you do need to know about two very special courts that exist district and below, right? You need to know what Gram Nyayalayas are, and you also need to know what Lok Adalats are, okay? Both of these are district and below, okay? The number of Gram Nyayalayas, the number of Lok Adalats will depend from state to state depending on infrastructure and resources available. Understood? Good. Now, let's come down to the primary differences between the two, right? First, look at the word Lok Adalat, right? Look at the word Lok Adalat. What does the word tell you? It means it's a court of the people, for the people, not by the people, right? It's a court of the people and for the people, right? So I have a very simple question for you. If it is a of the people and for the people court, right? Yes. This means it is always going to be a voluntary court, right? It's going to be a voluntary court. If both parties agree to come here, then only would the case be referred to a Lok Adalat, right? Absolutely clear on this? Good. Two, and an important question. This is where we get into the core essence of things. A civil wrong is a wrong between two people, right? A civil wrong is a wrong between two people. A criminal wrong could be a wrong between two people, but if a crime has been committed and a serious crime has been committed, somewhere the state has failed, right? Somewhere the state has failed. Give you two very practical scenarios. In case one, you were away on a holiday, somebody broke into your boundary wall, and illegally constructed their part of the building. The state couldn't do anything to prevent it. The state can try its level best to restore it to its original form, but the state cannot do anything to prevent it. Right? That's something which is civil in nature. Fair enough. Now, compare that to somebody getting murdered. The fact that somebody got murdered means somebody's life and liberty, Article 21, stopped to exist at that very point. And Article 21 is enforceable against the state. And it is the responsibility of the state to make sure that the least we can do for our citizens is to ensure that they are not killed. Correct? Yes. So now tell me, in Lok Adalats, will serious criminal offenses be entertained? In Lok Adalats, will serious criminal offenses be entertained? No. Clear on this? Understood this? simple enough? Yes. So you would look at petty civil and petty criminal offenses. Not you will not look at major criminal offenses. Right? Understood this? Sure. Pakka? Yes. Good. Now comes the second question. Right? Let us say you and your friends, right? You and your friends decide to pick a holiday spot. Okay? You and your friends decide to pick a holiday spot. You get to the holiday spot. Now one of your friends says, I don't like this place, so I am not going to pay for the hotel or the accommodation at that place. You will look at your friend and you will burn the friend alive by just the way you would look at your friend. Why? Because everybody agreed to do this. Lokadalat is, you agreed to do this. Because you agreed to do this, you might as well stick by it. Okay? So that is why the decisions of the Lokadalats are always binding on people. Right? Now, simple enough. I will not complicate it because questions are always asked in such a simple manner. Next question. In a Lokadalat, what is the philosophical purpose behind it? Why would you create another god when you have thousands of gods in the country? You would create another god because you want people to finish up their small little issues at a point of time. I'll give you an example. Imagine a matrimonial matter, a matter of divorce, and some very robust arguments are being given, right? The lawyer of the groom is saying that the bride is mixing poison in the groom's milk. The lawyer of the bride is saying that the mother of the groom is poisoning the wife's food. And your job as a judge is to decide who's poisoning who, or if at all somebody is being poisoned. Now look at this. Look at these people. These are very educated people. These are people who cleared very difficult competitive exams. They have thorough knowledge of the law. Imagine when they come home and then people at home will ask them, what did you do? I decided whether the wife or the mother-in-law or the husband, whoever is yes, poisoning whoever, right? So some things don't deserve the attention that they often get, right? So therefore, when you're looking at it, when you're looking at all of this, you want to create all of this. You want to create all of this at a lower court. Now, of course, the matrimonial example I gave you is actually a serious one. It doesn't fit here. But just imagine, like, for example, let us say somebody stole your cows. Now you file a case in the civil court. You go to the civil court and you say, Your Honor, four of my cows have been stolen by this man right here or this woman right here. The cows are missing me. I'm missing them too. And you're trying to figure out as a judge of an Indian judicial system, whose cow is it anyway? So matters like these must be closed once and for all. Understood this? Yes, understood. Good. So Lok Adalats are essentially parallel courts, right? Parallel courts wherein once decided, the matter is closed. We don't want you to burden the judicial system. There shouldn't be any appeal whatsoever. So, what are the kind of cases you look at? Mostly civil, very, very minor criminal cases. They're binding, they're voluntary, and there's absolutely no appeal. This is all you need to know as far as Lok Adalats is concerned. When I do past year papers with you, you'll understand why all of this information is more than enough. Now you come to your Gram Nyayalayas, right? Now, Gram Nyayalayas is nothing but satellite courts or smaller courts because you didn't have enough courts. Okay, so they are proper full-fledged courts. They would have both civil and both criminal jurisdiction. Okay, they will also have an appeal. They're essentially decentralizing courts. So if I put it in this way, Gram Nyayalaya is the Panchayati Raj version of the judiciary. You understand this? Gram Nyayalayas are the Panchayati Raj versions of the judiciary. So if in Panchayati Raj, you give our beloved Gram Sabhas and our Panchayat Samitis and our Zila Parishads all the powers that they so rightfully deserve, why would you not give the same powers to Gram Nyayalayas? Do we understand this? Why would you not give the same exact powers to Gram Nyayalayas? So Gram Nyayalayas are fully functional courts. You could be referred to it. You could go and appeal on this. It's essentially just a lower court. So Gram Nyayalaya technically is the only formal court you need to know, because it's new, because it's hip, because it's on the market. Clear on this? Understood this? Yes. Sure. Good. So the point of creating a Gram Nyayalaya was, we've already given you a lower court of occurrence, and appeals from the Gram Nyayalaya will go to the district court. Again, the prelims will not ask you, do appeals from Gram Nyayalayas always go to the district court? Because it depends on the nature of the case. These are complicated legal questions which are in the civil procedure code and they are in your criminal procedure code. Do we understand this? Is this clear? Okay, good. Then you also have sort of, you know, very specialized lower courts. Again, these courts are district and below. These are called, say, for example, family courts. This is where your divorce drama happens. This is where marriages which fail, which almost all do, are, some are reported, some are not. Very deep and a dark statement, right? Are reported. This is where the larger discussion of who poisoned who happens, right? Now, because these are complicated and serious criminal matters, they will then get on appeal to the High Court. Clear? Now, why do family court cases go on appeal to the High Court? Because family courts have been given the same status of a district court. It's the same thing as saying we're creating specialized courts at the district level. Okay? So family court is a specialized court. A specialized court, just think about it logically. Will you have a specialized court in a village? You don't have a court to begin with. Will you have a specialized court? कि मतलब तेल भराने के पैसे नहीं है मेरे पास और मैं मर्सिडीज खरीद के ले आया. Understood this? Yes. कि अब मैं रखूंगा घर में लेकिन ऐसे ही. So when you yes, when you do not have a court in a sub district to begin with, why would you even set up a specialized court? Every district will at least have a district court. So you can then think of a specialized court called a family court. Otherwise, everything below the district court is your civil courts are civil courts, criminal courts are session courts, and so on and so forth. Okay, good. Now, we'll finish the circumference first and then we'll come to the Supreme Court and the High Court. Right. Now, let's come to some other discussions. You would have heard of these words called tribunals, right? Tribunals. First things first, tribunals are higher specialized courts. Tribunals are higher specialized courts, which means they will always be above district level. Okay? They will always be above district level. No matter what, they will always be above district level. Are we clear on this? Do we understand this completely? No questions asked. Take. So, if you think about it, tribunals are just South Delhi versions of family courts. Fancier, in a higher societal position. Think about it. Tribunals are nothing but South Delhi versions of family courts. Because they are perceived to be in higher social structure, a higher strata, and they of course get all the resources in the world. So, depending on tribunal to tribunal, so you of course have 323A and 323B, which largely deal with the creation of tribunals, and there are a bunch of those, right? For example, for administrative matters, you have the Central Administrative Tribunal. You have the Income Tax Tribunal. You have the National Green Tribunal. Now, sometimes, you will have an inception happening in a tribunal. There'll be a tribunal and there'll be a higher tribunal. And then beyond the higher tribunal, will there be a proper court? So you will have appellate tribunals as well, right? So for example, you will have the competition tribunal, the competition appellate tribunal, right? Or you could have the income tax tribunal, the income tax appellate tribunal, right? Clear on this? Understood? Now, depending from tribunal to tribunal, right, depending from tribunal to tribunal. Yes, company law tribunal, company law appellate tribunal. Yes, enough and more. Depending from tribunal to tribunal, right? Depending from tribunal to tribunal. Some appeals from tribunals can go to the High Court. Some can go to the Supreme Court. I'll give you a quick trick. As far as the prelims is concerned, I don't need you to know which tribunal appeal goes to what court. Is this clear? Please don't sit and memorize this. Nobody is going to ask you this in the exam. Don't waste your time. Now, usually, tribunals that do not have appellate tribunals, usually, okay, are usually sent to the High Court. Tribunals would usually have appellate tribunals are sent to the Supreme Court. This is the usual case. Of course, NGT is an exception because it's a national tribunal. Clear on this? Understood? But in most cases, tribunals without appellate tribunals, you'd usually go and appeal to the High Court. Tribunals with appellate tribunals will usually go to the Supreme Court. There is no hard and fast rule as such. The government is free to change it however they want to, and all of those things exist. Clear on this? Understood this? Yes. Good. You don't have the National Green Appellate Tribunal. You just have the National Green Tribunal. Okay, you can have internal appeals in the same tribunal, but you don't have a separate organization for it. Okay? Right? Now, so, we've understood what tribunals are. Good. Now, a fundamental and a fairly conceptual question arises. Sir, we now know what a court is. We now know what a tribunal is. A tribunal is nothing but a specialized court, has almost the same powers of the court. We also want to know what a commission is, right? Consumer commission, consumer authority, yes. So what is the basic difference? This is your descending order of legal power. Courts have full legal power. Tribunals almost have full legal power. They cannot give you interpretation of laws as such. And commissions have partial legal power, right? In a court, you will always see members of the judiciary, right? Always. In a tribunal, you will see members of the judiciary and you will see retired members of the executive or experts, you may feel like, but you will never see a serving member of the executive, a permanent executive, ever to be a part of a tribunal. Clear on this? Understood this? Yes. Good. And as far as the commission is concerned, you will see members of the judiciary as well as your permanent executive who also sit in these commissions. So more often than not, when you go to these state consumer commissions, you will see a lot of civil servants also sitting next to judges, because you can do that. The reason behind this is they look at larger interpretations of laws. They look at implementation and the larger questions of laws. And these largely look at factual issues arising of the law. Commissions do not have any power whatsoever, of implementing, of interpreting the Constitution or any other law whatsoever. Okay, so courts usually will have only judicial members. Tribunals will usually have judicial members and experts, but they will never be serving members of the permanent executive. Commissions can have judicial members as well as serve members of the permanent executive. These are your three basic differences. This is all you need to know. Clear? All right. Yes. Now, let's come to our big boys, right? The Supreme Court and the High Court. And we'll discuss this comparatively, so you will not go wrong here. It'll be easy for you to understand it, right? All are created by law. All have to always be created by law, because we're a rule of law country. Okay, right? Okay, chaliye, aage badhte hain. Tribunal, Lok Adalat, Gram Nyayalay are constitutional or statutory bodies. Statutory bodies. Theek hai? There's no such thing called as a constitutional tribunal. Okay, yeah, usually the tribunal does not. Tribunal cannot interpret the Constitution. There are only two courts in this country who can. Those two courts are written in front of you. Let me continue. Okay, chaliye, aage badhte hain. Divyanshu, this is not a personal conversation, and you seem to be a smart kid, so please hold on. Article 263, Interstates Water Tribunal, has been created by inserting it in the Constitution, created because the Constitution allowed it. But the powers of the Interstate Water Tribunal are not given in the Constitution, which is why very recently when you amended or you proposed changes to the Interstate Water Tribunal, it did not require a constitutional amendment. Am I right, Divyanshu? Am I right? Yes. Thank you. Thanks. ऐसे नई दाढ़ी में वाइट किया है, बहुत पढ़ाई करके दाढ़ी वाइट किया है, तो सुन लिया करो थोड़ा सा इसे, है ना, इसलिए. हाँ, कि मतलब सर सर को पूछेंगे. चलिए आगे चलते हैं, शुरू करें. ऑल राइट, लेट्स स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द बिगनिंग. ओके, सुप्रीम कोर्ट. सबसे पहले तो समझते हैं सुप्रीम कोर्ट में जज कैसे बनते. दिस इज एक्चुअली वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. सुप्रीम कोर्ट में जज कैसे बनेंगे, व्हाट आर द क्वालिफिकेशंस नीडेड, टू बी अ सुप्रीम कोर्ट जज. थैंक यू विपिन, है ना. व्हाट आर द क्वालिफिकेशंस नीडेड टू बी अ सुप्रीम कोर्ट जज, बहुत ध्यान से सुनना. ऑब्वियसली यू नीड टू बी अ सिटीजन, दैट्स एब्सोल्युटली नो प्रॉब्लम. Clear? Now, you've got to be a high court judge for at least 5 years. Any high court consecutively, doesn't matter. Bas 5 saal ke liye high court ka judge hona chahiye tha. Yeah, you should have been a high court advocate for at least 10 years. Okay? Or you should have been a distinguished jurist. Jurist matlab a person, jurisprudence means knowledge of the law. Jurist means a person who has a knowledge of the law. So D.D. Basu is a jurist. M.P. Jain is a jurist. H.M. Sirvai is a jurist. Upendra Bakshi is a jurist. Lakshmikant is a purist. Chhodo yaar. Theek hai. Clear? Jurist wo hote hain. Theek hai. हम कोचिंग वाले हैं, हम ज्यूरिस्ट नहीं होते हैं, ठीक है. हम मार्क्सिस्ट होते हैं. राइट, ओके, अंडरस्टूड. चलिए, या अब रौनक ने पूछा है सर इस सुभाष कश्यप अ जूरिस्ट, एक तो जूरिस्ट इज नॉट एन ऑफिशियल टाइटल है ना फर्स्टली, तो मतलब आपको लगता है आप जूरिस्ट हैं तो आप हैं, मुझे नहीं लगता है, फर्क नहीं पड़ता, ठीक है। सो डिस्टिंग्विश्ड जूरिस्ट एज पर द प्रेसिडेंट विच बेसिकली मीन्स ऑन एडवाइस ऑफ द काउंसिल ऑफ मिनिस्टर्स, चलिए ठीक है। ये तो हो गया सुप्रीम कोर्ट के लिए, सिंपल। हाई कोर्ट के लिए देख लीजिए, ठीक है, सिटीजन सिटीजन कॉमन। अब हाई कोर्ट की जज के लिए, हाई कोर्ट के जज अगर आप पहले से ही होते तो क्या ही फायदा था, सो नॉट एप्लीकेबल, ठीक है, अंडरस्टूड दिस। हाई कोर्ट एडवोकेट फॉर 10 years, ये कॉमन है, इफ यू नोटिस ये कॉमन है, अंडरस्टूड दिस, क्लियर ऑन दिस, यस, ओके। नाउ लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड दिस एंड लेट्स फिगर दिस आउट, ठीक है। ये डिस्टिंग्विश्ड जूरिस्ट एज अ कॉन्सेप्ट डज नॉट अप्लाई इन द हाई कोर्ट, व्हाई, लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाई। व्हाई डू यू नीड अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड जूरिस्ट? यू नीड अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड जूरिस्ट, यू नीड अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड जूरिस्ट, एनी सिटीजन, यू नीड अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड जूरिस्ट टू इंटरप्रेट द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, टू हेल्प यू इन डिकोडिंग द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। Otherwise, the judges have absolute great knowledge of the law. The judges are going to do what they can do. Why do you need a distinguished jurist? Well, somebody who understands the law. Now, your question would be, doesn't High Court get to interpret the Constitution? Yes, they do. Does High Court get to not challenge laws, do laws that get challenged in the Constitution, challenged because of violating fundamental rights, do they not go to the High Court? Of course they do. All of that is great. We understand that. But all of those will always come on appeal to the Supreme Court. Let me ask you a simple question. Who is the final interpreter of the Constitution? A simple, basic prelims question. The Supreme Court is. So where would you require a distinguished jurist? In the Supreme Court. And think about it. We anyways are talking about an independent and an integrated judiciary. We're anyways talking about an independent and an integrated judiciary. The very fact that the president, on advice of the Council of Ministers, has been given the powers to appoint a distinguished jurist in the case of anything else not working out, is you already crossing a very dangerous line. Do you want to cross that line for the High Court as well? मतलब इतना ही क्या मतलब करो कि घर ही में घुस जाओगे क्या? I understand you want somebody who can help you interpret the Constitution. Fine, do this to the Supreme Court. But don't bring it all in the High Court. Why? Because there is something called rule number 2. You can't, you've already done enough against the states. Imagine telling the states that listen, see, you anyways don't have any powers to appoint or remove a High Court judge. Okay. It's going to be senior judges who will sit in a garden with a cup of tea in their hand, call themselves the collegium, and they will decide. The states are anyways making a sad face. And then imagine telling the states, you know what? My president, on my advice, can appoint a high court judge. Your collegium can go take a hike. Your collegium can go take a hike. Imagine. One should not push your limits so far. There's only to a limit that you should trouble the other person. Clear on this? Samhaj mein aaya? Yes. Are we clear? Understood this? That is why. Now comes the fun part. The fun part is, just pay attention to the highlighted portion. Okay? So basically, your eligibility criteria to becoming a Supreme Court judge and a High Court judge is the same? Yes. The eligibility criteria to becoming a Supreme Court judge and a High Court judge is the same. Let's understand this. And let me further break it down. Except center and state or state and state disputes. Listen to my words carefully. Except center versus states or state versus state disputes, the Supreme Court and the High Court do exactly the same thing? Yes or no? Think about it. Yeah. Except for center and state and state versus states, the Supreme Court and the High Court essentially entertain the exact same kind of cases. For everything that you can go to the Supreme Court, you could also go to the High Court. Right? Clear? Now comes the second part. For cases which include a center versus state dispute, or for cases which include a state versus state dispute, a center versus state dispute or a state versus state dispute. Those are two kind of cases. Government lawyers are going to fight those cases. Ordinary lawyers are anyways not going to fight. The central government lawyer is called the Attorney General of India. The state government lawyer is called the Advocate General of India. Yes. And the Attorney General of India and the Advocate General of India can anyways not become a Supreme Court or a High Court judge because of office of profit. You can't. Which means the only lawyers, okay, please understand this, the only lawyers who fight cases only in the Supreme Court are those lawyers who are either Advocate General or Attorney General. So everybody else who says that they are a Supreme Court lawyer are lying to you. That's my problem. There is no such thing called a Supreme Court lawyer. If you are only a Supreme Court lawyer, you're either the Advocate General of this country or an Attorney General of the country. You have chosen to only practice at the Supreme Court. That's your problem. You've decided to do that. But this doesn't mean that you only practice at the Supreme Court. It's your choice. Clear? Understood this. So, a 10-year, exactly. You can practice in any court. Yes. Good. The only thing that we add extra in a high court, they can't write it as a designation. The only thing that you can write additionally for high court qualifications is you could have also been holding a judicial office for 10 years, any lower court, anything for 10 years. ठीक है, understood? Yes. So a person, if for example I am a lawyer, let us say I decide to say I am a Supreme Court lawyer only, but if somebody says I'm going to give you a truckload of money and it is a good case, it is a model case, but you will have to argue in the district court, I will be at the district court at 5 a.m. in the morning. Do you understand? If it is a moral case, I'm on the right side of the case and they give me a truckload of money, which currently is a problem these days. So yes, main ready subah aise. Full. But wo puching, aren't you a Supreme Court lawyer? I said, no. I'm a lawyer. Yeah, clear. Understood. Yeah. Excellent. Cool. Perfect. So this is how it works. Yeah. So these are your qualifications. Okay. So you not forget them anymore. Next. Oath. Supreme Court, High Court. I don't need you to worry about this too much. A high court lawyer can also argue in the Supreme Court. There's no problem. Anybody can argue anywhere. The only thing is, there are only a few people in this country who can file cases in the Supreme Court. There are very few bunch. Those are called advocates on records. So what I do is, for example, I had to file a Supreme Court case very recently on behalf of some aspirants. So I hired a friend of mine who is an advocate on record, and that person filed the case, and we are collectively arguing the case. That's how it works. Oath is given by the president as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, and the governor as far as the High Court is concerned. Are we clear with this? Do we understand this? Why does this happen? Because it is otherwise logistically very difficult. Imagine the president spending half of his or her time simply giving you gyan on all of these things. Theek hai? Understood? Yes? Chalo. Next. Salary and pension. We've discussed this in the context of the parliament as well. So, the salary and the pension. Firstly, the salaries of the Supreme Court as well as the High Court judges are decided by the parliament. Center stronger than the states. Samajh mein aaya? Theek hai? Charge to Consolidated Fund of India, charge to the respective Consolidated Fund of States. Pension charge to Consolidated Fund of India, here also pension charge to the Consolidated Fund of India. Why? Because you, the parliament, has made a law prohibiting retired High Court judges to practice. You, the parliament, has made a law prohibiting High Court judges, prohibiting High Court judges from practicing in the court that they were High Court judges in. Understood this? Is this clear? Yes. Good. Retirement age. This is important. Supreme Court judges 65, High Court judges 62. Now you would have a question, but sir, why not 65 here? Because if you made this 65, no High Court judge would be able to become a Supreme Court judge. Yahan jaldi nipta ke phir 3 saal ke liye yahan leke aate. Do you understand this? Are we clear on this? That is why. Okay. Clear? Yeah. Done? All right. Next, let's look at the jurisdiction of these courts. I'm slightly unwell for the past day or two. Anyways, let me at least finish this part and then we'll talk. Okay. Next. Jurisdiction. Let's look at jurisdiction. All right. So, jurisdiction means, do courts have the power to hear your case? The power of the courts to hear your case. Hai na? This is a very simple question that millennials ask each other in modern day relationships. Am I worth you and are you worth my time? Na, ki matlab, I deserve much better. You deserve much better. That. So jurisdiction. The jurisdiction is nothing. Jurisdiction is nothing but the power of the court. Ki main to theek hoon. Kya court ke paas itni power hai ki aap mujhe sun sakein. Theek hai. Alright. So you have, I'll give you very simple explanations. Original, appellate, okay. Third, very simple ones. Advisory. Then, special leave. And then, writ. These are the only five kinds of jurisdictions that exist. Now, let's quickly look at Supreme Court and High Court. Okay. Supreme Court and High Court. And let's understand this in a larger domain. Chaliye. Let's continue. Let's figure this out. Okay. Original matlab, first time. For the very first time. Pehla pehla pyar. When the case goes to a court for the very first time. Okay. Now the Supreme Court has an exclusive original jurisdiction. Center versus states, state versus states. Now, for those of you glorious individuals will ask, sir, what about center with union territory? Now, if it is a case of center versus union territory with legislature, goes to the High Court of that Union Territory. If it is a case of center versus Union Territory without legislature, then there will not be a case in the first place, because a Union Territory without a legislature is the administrative territory of the center. ये हो ही नहीं सकता. आज तक कभी सुना है दिल्ली वर्सेस सॉरी यूनियन ऑफ इंडिया वर्सेस दमन एंड दीव? इतना बड़ा हो गया है, इतना बड़ा हो गया है कि माँ बाप से सवाल पूछेगा, माँ बाप से पूछेगा सवाल. Have you ever heard of a case that says Union of India versus Dadar and Nagar Haveli? है ना, कभी सुना ऐसे अंडमान? नहीं ना, इसलिए नहीं सुना. Clear? So your case of central government versus Delhi government, the Supreme Court judgment that happened in 2018, which has been discarded like trash, and the government of Delhi bill has been passed by the parliament. मतलब सोचो, ठीक है, वही. वो कहाँ गया था? वो दिल्ली हाई कोर्ट में गया था, फिर सुप्रीम कोर्ट. क्लियर ऑन दिस? ठीक है. नाउ एज फार एज ओरिजिनल ज्यूरिसडिक्शंस ऑफ द हाई कोर्ट आर कंसर्न, आई विल जस्ट गिव यू अ फ्यू एग्जांपल्स, बट यू डोंट हैव टू मेमोराइज दिस. आई विल गिव यू एग्जांपल्स, एंड दीज एग्जांपल्स लार्जली वर्क ऑन अ रूल नंबर टू प्रिंसिपल. फर्स्ट इज इलेक्शन पेटिशंस रिगार्डिंग द आउटकम ऑफ एन इलेक्शन. कि आपको लग रहा है कि काउंटिंग गलत हुई है, ठीक है, आपको लग रहा है कि काउंटिंग गलत हुई है, ईवीएम फेल कर गया है, तो आप उस स्टेट के हाई कोर्ट में केस फाइल करेंगे जिस स्टेट में इलेक्शन हो रहा था. क्यों? बिकॉज द इलेक्शन वॉज कंडक्टेड बाय द इलेक्शन कमीशन ऑफ इंडिया, सेंट्रली अपॉइंटेड बॉडी. The rules for the election were made by the Election Commission of India, centrally appointed body. The state was divided into constituencies according to the Election Commission and the Delimitation Commission, again centrally appointed bodies. Kuch to state ko de do, the candy ho gaya ki acha. Agar aapko results se problem hai, to aap ek kaam kariye, koi issue nahi hai, aap High Court mein aa jaiye. Theek hai? Clear? बट अगर आप कहते हो नहीं, वो बूथ ठीक से नहीं लगाया, वहां पे सीएपीएफ के लोग नहीं थे, मेरे को वीवीपैट की स्लिप नहीं मिली, मुझे इन्फॉर्म नहीं किया गया, वो देखो पॉलिटिकल रैली कर रहे हैं, पोस्टर निकाल रहे हैं, उसके लिए इलेक्शन कमीशन के पास जाओ. सो डिस्प्यूट्स विद रिगार्ड्स टू द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ इलेक्शंस विल ऑलवेज बी विद द इलेक्शन कमीशन ऑफ इंडिया. However, disputes with regards to the outcome of elections will always and always be with the High Court of India. Clear on this? Understood this? Good. Excellent. Apart from that, agar FIR quashed karani ho, to High Court jana padta hai. Because uske niche to koi option hi nahi hai. Right? Think about it. Uske niche to koi option hi nahi hai. Because the people who are filing the FIR are people who are members of the executive making and filing the FIR on a law which is either made by the center or made by the state. The only people who can now quash an FIR, cancel an FIR for the first time, happens to be the High Court. So, jitne bhi ye fake FIR wale issues hote hain, wo High Court mein jaate hain. Theek hai? Meri aapse haath jod ke minti hai, with closed and folded hands, it is my absolute because I just explained to you why High Court. It is my absolute plea to you. Please do not bother going through these appellate jurisdictions. Seedhi baat, civil or criminal case yahan pe bhi ja sakte hain. Civil or criminal case yahan pe bhi ja sakte hain. Samajh mein aa raha hai? Are we clear on this? Do we understand this? Pakka? Yes? Understood this? Sure. Great. Now, advisory. Advisory is also nothing but, again, an application of rule number 4, inter-checks and balances. ठीक है. High Court पे नहीं लगेगा, because anything that happens in the High Court, if is constitutionally that significant, will anyways come to the Supreme Court, so let's not bother the High Courts with it. यहां क्या होता है? Please understand how advisory jurisdiction works. L, E and J. As I told you, J is the cool loner kid. ठीक है. J is जब तक कांड नहीं हुआ है तब तक J के पास नहीं जा सकते. कांड हो गया, इशू हो गया, घटना घट गई, तो हम जे के पास जाएंगे, राइट? अदरवाइज इट विल बी अ वायलेशन ऑफ रूल नंबर 3, सेपरेशन ऑफ पावर्स, करेक्ट? यस, पक्का? अब देखो, ये बिल्कुल पर्दा सिस्टम है, लेजिस्लेचर भी खुद अकेले नहीं जा सकते, इतना मॉडर्न जमाना नहीं आया, अब तो खैर क्या ही है, एग्जीक्यूटिव भी खुद नहीं जा सकते, तो कौन बचा जो इन तीनों के ऊपर है, स्वर्ग में है, एपॉलिटिकल है, दुनियादारी छोड़ चुका है, सारे कस्मे वादे भूल चुका है, सब त्याग चुका है, प्रेसिडेंट, क्लियर? Understood. So obviously legislature तो नहीं पूछेगा. So council of ministers president बोलेंगे, president चचा, listen, इधर 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 काम करो, judiciary को पूछ के आओ. This is called advisory jurisdiction. Okay. Now the president can ask the judiciary two things. अब ध्रुवो ने आर्टिकल नंबर बता दिया है, क्या बढ़िया काम किया है ना, आगे चलते हैं. सो प्रेसिडेंट हैज कैन आस्क द जुडिशरी ओपिनियन ऑन टू थिंग्स, ओके, ऑन टू थिंग्स. वन, ऑन एनी मैटर, कुछ भी, एनी मैटर ऑफ पब्लिक इंपॉर्टेंस, एनी मैटर ऑफ पब्लिक इंपॉर्टेंस, ठीक है, अंडरस्टूड, कुछ भी. एंड दूसरा, एनी लीगल ऑब्लिगेशन अराइजिंग आउट ऑफ ए प्री कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन कमिटमेंट. एनी एडवाइस, मतलब कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के पहले हमने प्रॉमिस करा था फ्रेंच को कि आपको हम पॉन्डिचेरी दे देंगे, आप ही का है. पोर्चुगल में बोला था कि आप गोवा ले जाना, आप ही का है, क्लियर, आप ही का है, ले जाना. अब पोर्चुगल वाले आए, बोले सर आपने ना वादा किया था कि अकाउंट में पैसे आ जाएंगे, आए नहीं. देयरफॉर यू हैव टू नेसेसरीली रिप्लाई बिकॉज दिस इज अ मैटर ऑफ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल इम्प्लीकेशन. Understood, but the Council of Ministers cannot use the judiciary as a shoulder on which they can fire a gun on. ये नहीं कर सकते. This is very very important. कि मतलब देश में माहौल चल रहा है 370 का, homosexuality, transgender, uniform civil code, EWS, farm laws. बहुत pressure है government पे. Government का एक काम करते हैं, judiciary को पूछते हैं, पूछो पूछो पूछो. जुडिशरी बोलेगा बॉस मैं ओपिनियन दूंगा, और फिर वही ओपिनियन आप देश में चिपकाओगे, बोलोगे देखो जुडिशरी है गद्दार, हम तो आपके साथ हैं. तो फाइट योर बैटल्स योर सेल्फ, विच इज वाई द सुप्रीम कोर्ट इज नॉट बाउंड, द सुप्रीम कोर्ट इज नॉट बाउंड to reply to the president on on any matter of public importance, is not bound to reply on any matter of public importance. But ha, kuch pehle ka hai to hum jawab denge. Understand this as a simple modern day relationship. Okay, for example, one person in the couple asks the other person in the couple, where, what do you feel like doing this evening? बेटा कुछ भी जवाब देंगे, डांट खाएंगे, तुमने बोला था ये गलत है. But if you have a question, before you and I were together, this happened, you promised that person this, explain yourself. Yes, then you are bound to reply to your partner. समझ में आया? तो यही है, कुछ ऐसा ही समझ लो ये रिलेशनशिप. द सुप्रीम कोर्ट देयरफॉर इज बाउंड, ठीक है, देयरफॉर द सुप्रीम कोर्ट इज बाउंड टू गिव एन एडवाइस टू द प्रेसिडेंट on pre-constitutional commitments, but the Supreme Court isn't bound to give advice on any matter of public importance. Clear on this? Do we understand this? Is this okay? Is this fine? Yeah? Good. Excellent. Lovely. Theek hai. Done. Pakka. Perfect. Good. No, on matters before the constitution, before the existence, matlab 26 January 1950 ke pehle, isko hum kehte hain advisory jurisdiction on the basis of the president. Matlab, is desh mein president ko sirf ek insan mana kar sakta hai, wo hai Supreme Court. Theek hai. Then you have something called special leave petitions. Okay. Special leave petitions. Let's understand this and let's figure this out in a larger context. Theek hai. Bahut dhyan se suniyega. A special leave petition basically means your parents calling you in the middle of the night and saying, I don't care where you are, come home immediately. That's a special leave petition, which means a case could be at any court of the country, Supreme Court, Tribunal, Commission, District Court, Family Court, Lower Court, any court of the country. You, if you can prove that A, it is a matter of substantial legal importance, and two, there is a gross violation of injustice and it requires some amount of legal interpretation, then you can take leave from that court. Basically telling the lower court, chacha, aap se nahi ho paega, aage to Supreme Court jana hi jana hai, so why don't you let us go and speak to your bosses directly? Let me speak to your elders directly. Clear? So obviously, high courts will not get these powers, the Supreme Court will get these powers. Do we understand this? Is this clear? Is this okay? Yes, sure. So this is Article 136. Very simply put, any case pending in any lower court. Any case pending in any lower court. Of course, this is done on a case-by-case basis, which is why I will tell you something very interesting. Okay? Never in the prelims exam will you ever be asked what are the grounds of admitting an SLP, because the grounds of admitting an SLP are always on a case-to-case basis. Always. Always. Clear on this? Samajh mein aaya? Theek hai? So special leave petition. You will leave something where you're already existing, na Siddharth? Why will you go out from A to B? Theek hai? Pakka. And then finally, we compare the powers of the Supreme Court and High Court in the context of writ jurisdiction. We've covered this already, and we've already covered this. This is the larger discussion on fundamental rights under 32 and 226. Okay, so we've covered this. Do you remember this? So Supreme Court can issue writs on the basis of fundamental rights only 32, and high courts can issue on 226. Right? Yes? Sure? Pakka? Samaj mein aaya? Are we clear? And I also explained to you why high courts have wider powers than the Supreme Court. Right? Good. Guys, we're going to be covering two parts. Let's start with the first, local self-government. So sit back, sit tight. Let's understand this and let's make it a memorable season finale. Right? Chaliye, shuru karte hain. We're going to be discussing local self-government. Now, the problem with local self-government is that one tends to get into too much of detail as opposed to what is needed for this exam, right? All right, let's continue. The first thing we must understand when we study local self-government is we need to know things that we don't need to do. This is very, very important. Number one, any provision of local self-government which is dependent on states, okay, which is dependent on states, which means it is up to the states to implement them or not. it does not matter whether you need to do anything else. Are we clear on this? Do we understand this? Is this okay? Sure. Excellent. So anything which is dependent on states or is voluntary in nature is not to be done as far as the prelims is concerned. Two, I don't need you to know the details of the committees which were involved, which led to the formation of local self-government. Just the names are more than enough, which you can just pick up as it is. You don't need to know which committee said what in what amount of detail. Anyways, in the handwritten notes, I will give you like a table of one word and one line per committee. That is more than enough. Please don't do this in any further detail. Third, urban end of local government does not need to be done in a lot of detail. And a lot of these ancillary forms of, you know, ancillary forms of local self-government, such as you could say your cantonment boards or all of those things, they don't have to be done at all under any circumstances. For those of you who wish to become Indian Defense Estate officers, that is when you would be interested in cantonment boards, not any time before or after that. Are we clear on this? Yes. Otherwise, please don't bother with these ancillary forms of local self-government. Clear? All right. Now, let's get down to the primary discussion. Your discussion on local self-government largely runs on the concept of 3 Ds. Okay. D1 stands for delegation. D2 stands for decentralization. D3 stands for, please understand this, D3 stands for devolution. These 3 Ds are arranged in an ascending order, that is, from the lowest to the highest, in terms of transfer of power and the amount of power that you're transferring. So transfer of power is always from a higher to a lower authority. So as you go above and beyond, you start transferring more and more amount of power. Okay. So delegation means the transfer of administrative power. Decentralization means the transfer of administrative and a tad bit of financial power. Devolution means the transfer of administrative, financial, and most importantly, legislative power. Okay? Is this clear so far? So, local self-government is a journey here. Now the problem here is decentralization is our reality. Devolution is our dream when it comes to local self-government. I'll repeat this. Decentralization is our reality. Devolution is our dream when it comes to local self-government. And you must understand why. The reason why we say this is because local self-government is actually in the state list. Okay. What you're essentially trying to do is create another layer of government or another layer of authority. And that authority needs to be given power. The problem is, power is a lot like matter in physics. It cannot be created, nor it can be destroyed. It can only be transferred. As we understand that power is a very finite commodity as far as lawmaking is concerned. And all the powers that we have ever heard of, as far as the Constitution is concerned, are categorically mentioned in Schedule 7 of the Constitution, wherein your union list, your state list, and your concurrent lists clearly tell you the kind of powers that exist and who would exercise these powers. What you really have to do right now is take powers from here and build a new ecosystem. And if you think about it, you want powers to be exercised locally. So a logical and a very commonsensical guess would mean that most of the powers would be sacrificed from the state list and the concurrent list. So the first question comes, and a simpler question comes, how do I create a third level of government? Our constitution talks about center and states. Great. You now want to create a third level of government. Go back to our first discussion of the idea of constitutionalism. The idea of constitutionalism is to create a system which keeps a check on the powers of the government. What you're essentially doing is creating another level of government. What you're essentially doing is creating another layer of government. So therefore, it is only dignified, it is only courteous, it is only in the best interest that if you're adding another layer, it has to be dignified through making a change in the constitution, as you are going to be creating a new set of powers. Understood this? And of course, the states are going to be very, very affected to the extent of being very, very perturbed. So this is going to affect the constitution? Yes. Is it going to affect the states? Yes. Do I need to ask the states? Yes, because you are changing center-state relations. You are changing the powers of the states. So when you create the 73rd and the 74th constitutional amendment, the 73rd pertains to the rural part of the country and the 74th pertains to the urban part of the country, you have to pass this as a constitutional amendment under Article 368 with state ratification. Now let us understand this. You basically want to create another level of government within the states, which basically means the states are going to be upset. Take your attention to the usual daily soap operas which are aired on Indian television. So whenever in a typical patriarchal Indian family, a new daughter-in-law comes to the family, the first person who is shown to be threatened in our TV soap operas, because patriarchy sells in our country, is the mother-in-law. So the mother-in-law has to give up on certain house responsibilities. That is exactly what is going to happen to the states, right? So whatever you create in the 73rd and the 74th amendment, simply speaking, should not cross a line. You want to create a government, you create a government. You want to create another layer of power, you create another layer of power. But don't cross a line. Which is why the 73rd and the 74th amendments come with compulsory provisions and voluntary provisions. Things that you have to do, things that you may or may not do, depending upon you. Clear on this? So what is it that you have to do? You have to create your levels of government, right? Simple as that. You have to make sure there is a body that conducts elections on time. So you create a special body called the State Election Commission. The State Election Commission has nothing to do with the Election Commission of India. In fact, you would remember the State Election Commission to be in the news recently when the Supreme Court had remarked that we should have full-time members and dedicated members to state elections commissions in the country, and they should not be treated like they just exist for the sake of being there. Clear on this? So what you really need to do is create a body that helps you conduct elections. Great. Then you also need to make sure that there is an amount of money that comes in. Now, if the Finance Commission tells the center how to distribute money between the center and the states, the State Finance Commission does exactly that, and it only does is tells the states how to distribute money between the states and your local self-government bodies. Clear? Because our fundamental rights also ask us to empower vulnerable sections, which is why you will have adequate reservation for women, SCs, and STs. Is that correct? And they have already given you the figure for women reservation, which means 1/3 of every post held at a local body in a state will be always occupied by women. And SCST would depend on the population of the state. And they can very easily overlap, which means if a village has a majority population which belongs to the scheduled caste community, and the state has decided to also make it a reserved village for women, so in that village, the sarpanch must necessarily be a woman and must necessarily be a scheduled caste member. Do we understand this? So reservation here could be contained. Simple as this. And you would have your minimum ages to contest elections. Now, look at these provisions. All that we're asking you to create is an office, is a building. What one does at that building, what one does at that office depends on the states. The kind of powers you want to give, the kind of layers you want to add, you want to give an OBC reservation, go ahead, it is anyways up to you. You want to provide additional grants, it's entirely up to you. You want to give more powers, it is up to you. All that the center does is what we do for you, right? Spoon feed you, which means at the end of the month, the last 3 days of this month, I'm going to be conducting 3 special classes. Important schemes, reports, indices, and organizations. What I'm basically doing is presenting a platter in front of you, and I'm asking you to just memorize the platter. Whether you do it, how you do it, when you do it is entirely up to you. So this is exactly what the center also does. The center basically says, oh my dear states, I am just making life easier for you. I understand you want to create a rural layer of government. Here, I've created something called the 11 schedule for you. It has a bunch of items that we think you should give your panchayats. When, how, to what extent is entirely up to you. Similarly, for the urban part of it, we create the 12th schedule, which is why the 11th schedule and the 12th schedule happen to be the only 2 optional schedules in the constitution, which means these are the only 2 schedules which are enforced at will, if they want to, when they want to, how they want to. And the simplest reason behind this is rule number 2, the federal balance of this country. You've already forced the states. You have already forced the states to have 3 layers in rural, 2 layers in urban. You've already forced the states to have elections every 5 years and through a state election commission. You've already forced the states to set up a state finance commission. You've already told them to give a reservation to communities as listed before you, and you've already prescribed minimum ages. There is only so much that you can do. You go anything beyond this, you take a step beyond this, the states are not going to ratify it. Think about it. What you're essentially telling the states is that, listen, boss, you've got to have another layer of government because we think democracy needs to be evolved. Understood this? Clear on this? So this is the rationale behind local self-government. And this is exactly why we call this democratic decentralization, which is the transfer of administrative and financial powers. Levels of government is administrative, election conduction is administrative, SFC is financial, reservation is administrative, and requirement of minimum age is administrative. Your legislative powers are actually in the 11th and the 12th schedule, which is why I tell you the reality of local self-government is decentralization. The dream for local self-government is devolution. Do we understand this clearly? This is why you use the words decentralization for local self-government and devolution for as an objective or as an accomplishment that we want to achieve. Clear? Understood. Excellent. Now, let's get down to how it is actually done. What you're essentially trying to do is create a local L and a local E, which means you want to create a local version of a Lok Sabha or a state legislative assembly, and you want to create a local version of your elected executive and your permanent executive, right? Now, let's understand this. The primary purpose of doing everything that we're doing here is essentially grassroots in nature, which means you should take it to as grassroots as possible, right? You should take this to as grassroots as possible. Now, at the local level, below the constituency level, there are largely four very, very simple hierarchies. The lowest is a village, then is a block, then is a subdivision, and then is your district. Clear? Now, at the legislature level, what you essentially do is you create separate rural and separate urban, right? Even the same is replicated. You have rural executive, you have urban executive, right? Now, we know executive is of two types. You have rural elected executive and you have urban elected executive, correct? And you have rural permanent executive and you have urban permanent executive. You're essentially creating a separate layer. Yes. And you want to go as grassroots as possible, right? Sure. Now the difference is when you come to the permanent executive part, you further divide it. You say rural permanent executive civil, rural permanent executive police. Okay, so civil police. In the same way, urban permanent executive civil and urban permanent executive police. This is why you create a multi-layered government setup. You don't have this differentiation between civil and police at the center. You only have a larger administrative framework. right? You have a defense secretary at the center, a foreign secretary at the center. Ever heard of a defense secretary of a district? Ever heard of a foreign secretary of a district? No. You've heard of a DM, you've heard of an SP. You create as grassroots divisions as possible. Even at the state, there is a chief secretary, there is a DGP, and you have civil and police administration running parallelly. The difference is the police administration is below the civil and administration. So as you go more grassroots, you further diversify your organization. Okay. Anyways, permanent executive, whether it is rural or urban, is not in your syllabus, but because it creates intrigue value, I will still teach you this. You don't need to worry about it. You will not be asked the permanent executive side of things as far as the exam is concerned, because it can vary from state to state. Clear? Understood this? Simple enough? Yes? Good. So, I want to create the Lok Sabha or the state legislative assembly at the village level. And I'm going to call it the Gram Sabha. The only difference is you elect the Lok Sabha, you elect members to the state legislative assembly. Here, you are the assembly, you are the Lok Sabha. You are not electing an MP or an MLA in the village. You are the MP and the MLA of the village, which is why we say anybody above the age of 18 in a village is automatically a member of the Gram Sabha of that village, which is also why we say Gram Sabhas are the only functional tools of direct democracy. Remember direct democracy? Yes, because you are the legislator, you are not choosing the legislator. So everything that you do is essentially a form of initiative or recall. Clear on this? Understood? Good. That is how it works. On the urban counterpart, because it's urban, so it has to sound fancy, so it says ward. You can't call it Gram Sabha. It won't sound cool enough. So ward. Clear on this? Understood this? Good. Now, just compare it to the center and state elected executive. At the center, you have something called the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. At the state, you have the Chief Minister and the Council of Ministers. That's exactly what you replicate here. So, if it is a small village, there is no need for a Council of Ministers. Only the Sarpanch would be more than enough. Correct? Yes. But if it is a big village, then you could have something called a Gram Panchayat. Is this okay? Do we understand this? Now, I am sure all of you learned individuals in this class, a few of you will say, but sir, in my state, this is how it happens. Congratulations. These can be named differently in different states. We are very proud of your state to be individual here, but it doesn't really matter. Samajh mein aaya? Clear? Because this is a question I get every time I'm teaching local self-government. Sir, hamare state ke hamare gaon mein aise hota hai, sir. To ye kya hai? Good. Irrelevant. Theek hai? Similarly, you have, yes, ward. So you have the chairperson of the ward and the ward council. So small ward and a big ward will have a council. Okay. Piyush, just stop yourself from commenting, because what you're saying is as incorrect as conducting a Kumbh Mela in this country. Okay. Right. So let us continue. So here you would have a ward chairperson, right? A ward chairperson. And if it's a big ward, then you would have a ward council. Clear? Understood this? Great. Now, let's look at the final layer. In the rural permanent executive civil, you will have your tehsildar. At the rural permanent executive police, you will have your sub-inspector or inspector. Correct? Yes. Excellent. Urban permanent executive, these are called section officers, and again these are called sub inspectors. These names can change from urban area to urban area. So our first building block, is clear and it is done. Understood this? Yes, sure. Okay, next block. Okay, block. Now, what is Gram Sabha? As a village Lok Sabha, you have Panchayat Samiti as a block Lok Sabha. Okay, so everybody is a member of the Panchayat Samiti as well. Clear? Or you can have indirect elections also. That depends on the states. How you choose the Panchayat Samiti is entirely up to you. Clear on this? Understood this? Is it fine? Yeah. In the urban counterpart, you do not have anything at the block level. So therefore, you do not have any urban elected executive. The same way, you have PM of Panchayat Samiti and COM of Panchayat Samiti. So it is called Head of Panchayat Samiti and Panchayat Samiti Council. Clear? Head of Panchayat Samiti or Panchayat Samiti Council. Clear on this? The same thing. Are we okay? Are we fine with this so far? Good. Once we fill all of this, I'll explain the technicalities also. So, rural permanent executive civil. The rural permanent executive civil will be a BDO. And the rural permanent executive police will be your SHO. Clear on this? But you will also have urban permanent executive, right? So you will have a community development officer or chief development officer or, you know, block development officer. They can be called the same, right? Here also you will have an SHO. Okay. So Panchayat Samiti, Head of Panchayat Samiti, Panchayat Samiti Council, BDO, SHO, CDO and SHO. So same thing. Now you have closed the block. Okay. Now you come to the subdivision. The subdivision is the easiest because the subdivision has absolutely no rural or no urban representation. So no rural elected executive, no urban elected executive. The absence of an institution creates a void of power, and the void of power is consumed by these guys. So the rural permanent executive civil is SDM. The rural permanent executive police is SDPO, subdivisional magistrate, subdivisional police officer. When all of you make it through this exam, you will be starting your careers, your first official posting, your first proper independent charge is going to be here. Okay. In the urban permanent executive, to put it very simply, yes, let's understand this, right? See, Rahul again is acting smart. He sir, all states but no SHO in West Bengal. No problem, beta. Then let there be no SHO in West Bengal. Very good. Congratulations. But is it necessary for me to stop class and answer this when I clearly told you that do not worry about state variations? This is a general description. So don't act smart. Okay. Next. Urban permanent executive. Let's understand urban permanent executive. Let's get this right. Okay. Now. CEO has to be a fancy name. Chief Executive Officer, right? CEO, Chief Executive Officer. right? And ACP can change from state to state, but ACP. Clear on this? Cool names. Assistant Commissioner of Police, right? Sure? Or Chief Executive Officer. So cool. Amazing. And that is how you call close subdivision. Then you come to the big leagues. You have the Zilla Parishad here. And depending on the size of the urban area, Chotu urban area, municipality. Chotu urban area, municipality. Mid-size urban area, municipal council. Really big area, then municipal corporation. Really big area, municipal corporation. Are we clear on this? Do we understand this? Is this simple enough? Good. So Delhi has New Delhi Municipal Corporation, the haves. MCD, the have nots. Municipal Corporation of Delhi. ठीक है? खुशी और गम में यही फर्क है. NDMC, MCD. Okay. Similarly, you have Head of Zilla Parishad Council, depending on state to state. Okay. Similarly, you have Mayor and Mayor Council, depending on state to state, depending on the strength. Clear? Understood this? Good. Okay. Now, yes. Let's come to the next part. The Rural Permanent Executive Civil and Police, DM, SP, okay, Commissioner and SSP, or you would want to call them CP, theek hai? Understood this? CP or Commissioner of Police or any of those names, theek hai? So you will have a Commissioner here and you can have a DCP or a higher rank, again depends from state to state. Now, let us focus on these a bit because this is what is itching you the most. Okay, so let us pay attention. You have the cabinet secretary assisted by some secretaries at the center, foreign secretary, home secretary, defense secretary, commerce secretary, education secretary. At the state level, you have the chief secretary assisted by the home secretary, education secretary, health secretary, commerce secretary, industry secretary, and all of those things. Don't you think these guys should also be assisted? Yes. So DMs are assisted. DMs are assisted by ADMs. SPs are assisted by DYSPs. So ADMs are nothing but a kind of a secretarial cabinet of the DM. So you will have ADM land, ADM law and order, ADM panchayat, ADM welfare, ADM education, ADM this, ADM that. Clear? As in ADM, you work out of the district headquarter. Clear on this? Similarly, when you have a commissioner here, you have assistant commissioners here. Similarly, when you are a DCP here, you also have assistant DCPs or additional DCPs here. Clear on this? So there'll be DCP wireless, DCP traffic, DCP police housing. All of these additional DCPs work under a larger DCP. Clear on this? Okay. So the fun postings are actually SDM, SDPO, DM, and SP. Right? These are the guys who are returning officers in an election. These are the guys who literally have absolute command over their administrative regions. That is why, and think about it, they start your career here. Okay? Because when you are starting here, you have absolutely no direct political counterpart. All your political counterparts are below you. Do you understand this? So that you can work. Clear? This is why this is a very, very well thought out reason as to why you start as SDNs. Clear? Okay. Understood. Similarly, you will have SDMs who are, then you also have DMDCs. So DMDCs are assisting the SDMs or ASDMs. So similarly, at the subdivision level, you have ASDM law and order, ASDM welfare, ASDM this, ASDM that. Similarly, at the BDO level also, they will have a bunch of people assisting. So you will have these sub officers here also. Okay, that is how it works. Okay. Anyways, as great as it is irrelevant for the prelims exam. So let's get back to where things matter the most. So listen to me very carefully. Okay, let's get down to business. So an average Indian citizen who lives in a rural part of India casts a total of 5 votes. And I'll explain to you how these 5 votes. An average Indian rural citizen is entitled to cast 5 votes. Vote number 1, you elect your sarpanch. Vote number 2, you elect your head of panchayat samiti. A block is nothing but a combination of villages. A district is nothing but a combination of blocks. It's a collective noun. Vote number 3, you elect your head of Zilla Parishad. All right. Vote number 4, your MLA. Vote number 5, your MP. मतलब सोचो उसको पूरा टाइम बिजी रखा है कि चलो चलो आओ पंचायती इलेक्शन वोट कराओ, चलो चलो आओ जिला परिषद वोट कराओ. So what usually happens is, now most of these local elections, now it's an unwritten kind of a law, but the idea is local elections, please listen to this carefully. Local elections, the BDO party is responsible. State elections, SDMs are responsible. MP elections, your DMs are responsible. Clear? Of course, everybody supervises everybody, but aisa hi hota hai. Ki sarpanch ka election BDO ka hai, MLA ka election SDM ka hai, aur MP ka election DM ka hai. ठीक है. So in an MP election, the DM is the returning officer. In an MLA election, the SDM is the returning officer. In a panchayati election, the BDO is the returning officer. This is how you run it. ठीक है. So what do these BDOs do? They conduct all of these 3 elections in one go. अरे इंसान तो वही है. गांव, गांव का ब्लॉक, ब्लॉक का डिस्ट्रिक्ट. तो बोलेंगे अच्छा अच्छा चलो सरपंच का वोट डालो, अच्छा अच्छा पंचायत समिति का वोट डालो, अच्छा अच्छा जिला परिषद का वोट डालो. तो तीनों वोट लेके निपटा देते हैं ताकि हो जाए, चलो 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 डन. क्लियर ऑन दिस? सो फॉर द स्टेट्स हु कैन डू दिस, दे डू दिस लाइक दिस. An average urban Indian citizen votes a total of 4 times. Okay, first vote ward, second vote choosing your mayor, third vote MLA, fourth vote MP. Now in some states, corporators are chosen from ward, which is the same thing as a ward chair. Ward chairs automatically become members of the mayor council. So some states do it like that. Every state has their own way to go about it. The only thing is, and please listen to this very carefully. Now, Shivi, I will stop everything and discuss what happens in Delhi. Very, very important. Correct? Yes. Chaliye, aage badhte hain. Ward chairperson chosen by members of the ward. Nahi, everybody, you're a member of the ward. Hai na, Rajendra Nagar mein jo log rehte hain, likha nahi hai ward number 32, 34, 36, 38. Likha hai na. To anybody who lives in that ward is a member of that ward. Theek hai, aise galiyon mein jaoge Rajendra Nagar mein, aise ward likha rehta hai. Theek hai. So what is compulsory? You've got to conduct direct elections here. ये बहुत ज्यादा जरूरी है. बाकी आपको जो करना है करो, जैसे करना है करो, हमें कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता। आपको यहां डायरेक्ट करना है करो, यहां डायरेक्ट करना है करो, वी आर वेरी हैप्पी। यहां डायरेक्ट करना है करो, यहां डायरेक्ट करना है करो, मुझे कोई इशू नहीं है। यहां से फिर यहां इनडायरेक्ट करना है, फिर यहां इनडायरेक्ट करना है, फिर यहां इनडायरेक्ट करना है, फिर यहां इनडायरेक्ट करना है करो। जो खिचड़ी पकानी है पकाओ स्टेट बाबा, मेरे को सिर्फ इधर चाहिए डायरेक्ट इलेक्शन। क्लियर? सो यू शुड ऑलवेज हैव डायरेक्ट इलेक्शंस हियर। समझ में आया ये? बाकी तुमको जो करना है जैसे करना है, मेरा सर नहीं खाना। क्लियर? अंडरस्टूड दिस? गुड, एक्सलेंट। ठीक है, बिकॉज सम पीपल विल से सर मेरे मेरे स्टेट में, सर मेरे मेरे स्टेट में सर ग्राम पंचायत पंचायत समिति होती है और उसमें से सरपंच। ग्रेट, गुड फॉर यू, बट सर आपने तो बोला था ऐसे नहीं होता। मैंने क्या बोला था? ये मिनिमम है, इसके ऊपर आपकी आस्था, आपकी श्रद्धा, आपका मन, जो करना है करो, हमें कोई दिक्कत नहीं, हम कुछ नहीं बोलेंगे। आर वी क्लियर ऑन दिस? डू वी अंडरस्टैंड दिस? यस, पक्का, श्योर, क्लियर? ठीक है, ग्रेट, ओके। थैंक यू मैकियावेली, आई विल डेफिनेटली हैव अ लुक फॉर श्योर। ठीक है, थैंक यू, जस्ट गिव मी सम टाइम, आई विल हैव अ लुक एंड वी शेयर इट विद द क्लास। ठीक है, समझ में आया ये? पक्का, गुड। इतना ही है टोटल इकोसिस्टम में, इसके ऊपर कुछ भी नहीं है। समझ में आया? बस ठीक है, प्लीज डू नॉट गेट इनटू अननेसेसरी कॉम्प्लिकेशंस फ्रॉम हियर। नोबडी इज गोइंग टू आस्क यू दिस कॉम्प्लिकेशंस, दिस इज मोर देन इनफ। ठीक है, ग्रेट। नाउ लेट्स कम टू द नेक्स्ट पार्ट। द नेक्स्ट पार्ट इज अ फेयरली सिंपल वन। वी अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस इज द होल फिलोसफी बिहाइंड लोकल सेल्फ गवर्नमेंट इज टू एम्पावर लोकल। ये तो हमें क्लियर हो गया, द बेसिक फिलोसफी बिहाइंड लोकल सेल्फ गवर्नमेंट इज टू एम्पावर लोकल। यस, सिंपल इज दिस? आर वी श्योर? आर वी 100% ओके विद दिस? ग्रेट। द प्रॉब्लम इज अप्लाई आर्टिकल 14 इक्वल प्रोटेक्शन ऑफ लॉ, ट्रीट ऑल लोकल्स लोकली एंड ट्रीट डिफरेंट लोकल्स डिफरेंटली। यस और नो? करेक्ट, यस। फॉर एग्जाम्पल, यू आर अ दिल्ली पर्सन, वेन यू मीट अ बॉम्बे पर्सन, द बॉम्बे पर्सन इज गोइंग टू लूज देयर विट। नो बॉम्बे पर्सन लाइक्स अ दिल्ली पर्सन कि ओहो हो, वॉट इज दिस, वाई आर यू गाइज यू नो लिविंग इन हाउसेज विच। मतलब हमारे दिल्ली में हमारा बाथरूम बॉम्बे का 3 BHK होता है। ठीक है, तो उनके आंसू निकल आते हैं। ठीक है, when a Bombay person comes to Delhi and sees the way we Delhi people drive, Bombay people decide to never drive in their life, right? Now when we Delhi people go to Bombay, when we Delhi people go to Bombay, we see people are civilized. Cabs are actually going by the meter. They are not refusing only. So we lose faith in humanity. कि इतने अच्छे लोग कि कैब हमें मना नहीं कर रही, क्योंकि बिल्कुल जाएंगे, चाहे 2 बजे हो, 4 बजे हो, 6 बजे हो, इतना सिविलाइज्ड। एंड देन व्हेन वी गो टू बॉम्बे वी सी एवरीथिंग हैज पावर ओवर इट, सो वी अगेन लूज सैनिटी। कि ऑमलेट में पाव, बड़ा में पाव, पाव में पाव, मतलब पाव में पाव क्या होता है? करेक्ट, यस। So, treat different locals differently. In the same way, we have a bunch of locals in our country who are dependent on their local habitat. Correct? They are dependent on their local habitat, and these are the people who you would usually find इन द शेड्यूल्ड एरियाज, है ना, ये शेड्यूल्ड एरियाज में होते हैं, सम हिली एरियाज ऑफ द नॉर्थ ईस्टर्न स्टेट्स. सो यू वॉन्ट टू ब्रिंग लोकल सेल्फ गवर्नमेंट हियर, यू गॉट टू गिव देम एन एक्स फैक्टर. यस, यू गॉट टू गिव देम मोर, बिकॉज दीज लोकल्स इन दीज शेड्यूल्ड एरियाज आर नॉट द सेम एज साउथ दिल्ली लोकल्स. साउथ दिल्ली लोकल्स क्या बोलते हैं कि हम नेचर्स बास्केट से पार्मेजन चीज खरीद के लाएंगे और हम बैठ के अल्फ्रेडो पास्ता बनाएंगे. करेक्ट, ये बोलते हैं कि हम आज शिकार करके आएंगे, उसको रोस्ट करेंगे और खाएंगे. यस, ये बोलते हैं एवोकाडो टोस्ट, ये बोलते हैं हमारे यहाँ एवलांच आ जाएगा. फर्क है, बिग डिफरेंस. So, you need to give them more powers. You need to give them a sense of ownership. Yes, think about it. Yes, you need to give them a sense of power, a sense of ownership. So, you say local self-government plus X factor is equal to Panchayati Extension Scheduled Areas Act. Now you would ask a question, sir, local self-government may be required a constitutional amendment, but in Panchayati Extension Scheduled Areas Act, in Panchayati Extension Scheduled Areas Act, you only mentioned act. It is a normal law. It is an ordinary law. Why do you not require a constitutional amendment? Because the constitution gives the parliament to make laws to specially take care of these areas. Tabhi to scheduled area banaya tha, taki hum inke liye kuch special kar sake. Right? To inko hum apne area pe ownership dete hain. Ki minor produce, माइनर मिनरल्स, आपको आपके एरिया में दारू बंद करनी है तो बंद कर देना. हायर टैक्सेशन पावर्स, यू नो, प्रोहिबिशन पावर्स. करेक्ट, सो यू कैन अप्लाई ऑल ऑफ दीज थिंग्स इन योर लोकल एरियाज. दैट इज हाउ द पीसा एक्ट ऑफ 1996 केम इनटू बी. समझ में आया, ये बहुत बेसिक फंडा है. ये क्यों किया, क्योंकि द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑलरेडी एम्पावर्स द पार्लियामेंट टू मेक स्पेशल लॉज फॉर शेड्यूल्ड एरियाज. ठीक है, अंडरस्टूड दिस? आर वी कंप्लीटली फाइन विद दिस? यस, आई विल गिव यू अ लिस्ट कि कहां कहां अप्लाई होता है, कहां कहां नहीं, एंड दिस फॉर अ सिलेक्ट नंबर ऑफ प्लेसेस. इसका मतलब, लेट अस से फॉर एग्जाम्पल, ये हमारा एक स्टेट है. इस स्टेट का ये वाला एरिया scheduled area, this is a scheduled area and the rest of it is a normal area. To yahan pe lagega 73rd, 74th, yahan lagega PISA. Samajh mein aaya? Are we clear? It is that simple. Clear? The boundaries are clearly demarcated as addendum, so you know where the scheduled area starts, where the scheduled area ends. This is how it is actually implemented at the level of the state. Clear? Theek hai? Understood this? Right. Now, if this was a mains class, I would have taught you this. So, what I would have taught you is the larger mess that we have created at a state. So, at a state, you have MP constituencies, then you have MLA constituencies, correct? Then you also have three tiers of government. So you will now then have rural and urban. So let us say this is rural, this is urban, this is rural, this is urban. In this you will have your three tiers. Here you will have two tiers. Yahan pe MP bhi hoga, MLA भी होगा, DM भी होगा, SP भी होगा, सरपंच भी होगा, हेड ऑफ पंचायत समिति भी होगा, हेड ऑफ जिला परिषद भी होगा. तो सब मेल्ट के यहाँ पे खिचड़ी मंगा रहे हैं. क्लियर ऑन दिस? ठीक है, which is why we say urban and rural should come together and they should work together. So you create a district development agency where urban elected government and rural elected government work together under the larger aegis of the collector. So you have these participation mechanisms. ठीक है, बस पूरा local self government में इतना ही है. समझ में आया? All right. Now before I give you a 5-minute break, let us see what Machiavelli has shown us. We must see what he has shown us. My life, my rules. How sweet of you. How nice. Right? Yes, you can write this in article form. This is so nice. Very sweet of you. This is very sweet. The color of the lips is slightly misleading, but for everything else, it seems to be okay. Right? Gram Panchayat secretary same as Tehsildar is fine. Yes. Theek hai. This is beautiful. This is genuinely beautiful. This is very nice. How sweet. Machiavelli, even my parents don't love me so much. This is very sweet. Chalo. I will now give you a 5-minute break. Okay. And then we will begin in just about 5 minutes. Okay, 5 minutes. Okay, thank you. At 10 o'clock, we'll start. Yes, Tanvi, I'm going to soon liya. Come here after this. Happy Bihu, Machiavelli. Assam is beautiful this time of the year during Bihu. Lovely cuisine and all of those things. No, Shivam. Vajiram is my ex. I am not teaching at Vajiram anymore. Okay? Yes, Vartika, tomorrow indeed. Happy Ugadi to you. And Anurag tomorrow by all means. Thank you. If I'm wearing a t-shirt, then I'm teaching here. Anyways, take a 5-minute break, please. We are back. Yes, important laws as well will be conducted. Anirudh, I will reschedule it for you tomorrow. Yes. What elections are compulsory, Shweta? Okay. All right. Now, let's move to the next part. Okay. Sure. Now, I'm going to briefly cover some bodies with you and the larger context of bodies with you. And if you understand the concept, we've done this before, but this is for revision purposes. You will never go wrong with these bodies. Okay. And let us go. Garima has a very, very good score. 94 marks is one of the highest we've seen. Chali, aage chalte hain. Theek hai? Now, don't worry if you have a 94. Chali. Let's continue and let's figure out what more can be done. All right. So, chali, let's start. We're now going to be discussing bodies. Now, this is very similar to rights. Okay, so we understand there are something called fundamental rights. There are something called constitutional rights. And there are something called statutory rights, which the UPSC most happily calls legal rights. Okay, so fundamental rights, constitutional rights, and statutory rights. Correct? These are the three things that we often call them as, right? Sure. Okay. Yes, I'll share them. I'll share with you again. Good night again. Why good night again? Just give me a second, please. This is a little urgent. चलिए आगे बढ़ते हैं ठीक है लेट्स कंटिन्यू एंड लेट्स फिगर दिस आउट लेट्स स्टार्ट सो इफ यू हैव फंडामेंटल राइट्स कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट्स एंड स्टैट्यूटरी राइट्स यू शुड आल्सो हैव फंडामेंटल बॉडीज कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल बॉडीज एंड स्टैट्यूटरी बॉडीज नाउ You do not require a fundamental body or a body to implement fundamental rights because they are negative obligations on the state. Why would you need a body to enforce negative obligations on the state? Which is why you have constitutional bodies and statutory bodies. So bodies which are in the constitution are constitutional bodies. Bodies which are outside the constitution are statutory bodies. Which now brings me to a very interesting question. So is the president a constitutional body? Is the speaker a constitutional body? Is any body mentioned in the constitution a constitutional body? No, the answer is an absolute no, not at all. Any body mentioned in the constitution is not a constitutional body, which means our fundamental discussion is why are constitutional bodies called constitutional bodies, right? For that, let us start our understanding of 5 minutes into something very, very basic, into something very, very basic, something very, very simple. Okay, so simple. What makes a court a judicial body? A court is a judicial body because a court is performing a judicial function. Any body which performs a judicial function is a judicial body. So what is a judicial function? A judicial function is a question of law and a question of fact. A question of law and a question of fact. This is very clear. This is absolutely fine. Okay. Sure. Good. So what does this mean next? What is a question of law? What is a question of fact? The simplest way to understand this is through an illustration, is through a simple example. Okay. And I use a very common example. Let us say I'm walking on the road wearing this glorious t-shirt which I am so happy wearing on a daily basis. It shows on my face. Now, of course, I am wearing this glorious t-shirt, and one of you see me on the street, and then how a bull gets charged with the color red, you get charged with the Unacademy t-shirt, and you take out your dagger and you come towards me, and everything that you have against the t-shirt converts into your power, and you just stab me with a knife. Now, two things have happened. One, very likely. One, did you stab me with a knife? This is called a question of fact. Is stabbing me with a knife a crime? This is called a question of law. Okay? So, did an event happen or not is a question of fact. Is that event a violation of law is a question of law. So anybody who performs both of these functions happens to be a judicial body. So our equation is, a judicial body performs a question of law and a question of fact. Like good school-going children, let us divide LHS and RHS by two. So half of a judicial body is equal to, because these are finite variables, either a question of law or a question of fact, right? Either a question of law or a question of fact. Understood this? What is another name for half a judicial body? A quasi-judicial body. So quasi-judicial body is a question of law or a question of fact. Okay? Understood this? This becomes our first derivation. We're okay with this? Everybody understood how we came to this? Yes? Now, we come to the next part. Okay? All A is B does not mean all B is A, basic CSAT principle, right? So, yes, all constitutional bodies are quasi-judicial bodies, but all quasi-judicial bodies are not constitutional bodies. This becomes derivation number two. Let's understand why. This is the L. This is the E, this is the J. We're going to apply rule number four, inter and intra checks and balances, right? This constitutes the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. This constitutes of the permanent executive and the elected executive. And this, of course, as we know, is the Supreme Court and the High Court, right? Now, the principle of intra checks and balances is that you keep a check on each other inside L, inside E, and inside J. This is sorted because the Lok Sabha tends to have more powers. Judiciary is sorted because the Supreme Court is a supervisory body. The problem is here. The elected executive will own the permanent executive, right? But the permanent executive has been made the permanent executive because it could keep a check on the populism of the elected executive, because it could keep a check on the identity of the elected executive. Yes or no? Are we clear on this so far? Are we fine with this so far? Yes. Now, elected executive is an elected body. We really can't do anything about it. They are an appointed body. So, you've got to give them an Avengers superpower. You've got to give them something so that they can stand the wrath of elected executive. Otherwise, the elected executive will eat them alive. Otherwise, the elected executive will chew them alive. Isn't that the case? Isn't that how it works? Yes. and we're absolutely 110% sure of this. Clear? So we give them certain benefits, such as you cannot reduce salaries to their disadvantage. Their salaries will most likely be charged to the Consolidated Fund of India. You will require a tougher majority to remove them. Correct? And only then you give them a sense of independence to fight or question the elected executive. And that is how, and the only place you can give them those powers is the Constitution. The only place you can give them those powers is the Constitution, which is why they are called constitutional bodies. So constitutional bodies are those bodies which in some way or another are performing some sort of a check and balance function in the country. Whether it is the Election Commission, the Finance Commission, the CAG, or anybody that you can think of. The National Commission for Scheduled Castes, the National Commission for Scheduled Tribes, and so on and so forth. Now, think about this, and this is where it gets very interesting. The intensity with which you're performing a check and balance function. If you're performing an active check and balance function, right? Clear? Okay, if you're performing an active check and balance function, just think about it, an active check and balance function. What you're doing is essentially what the judiciary does, keeps a check on the actions of the legislature and the executive. Yes, keeps a check on the actions of the legislature and the executive. Active means you are looking at the overall functions of the executive or the legislature. Clear? Overall functions of the executive or the legislature. For example, elections, the way the money has been spent. These are active check and balance functions. Okay, Shweta, are we clear on this? So anybody who's performing an active, an aggressive, or an advanced check and balance function is essentially doing the same thing as the judiciary. Are we clear on this? The judiciary also does this. The only difference is judiciary does this after something has been committed. It's only doing it when the case reaches the judiciary. These guys are trying to be internally accountable to one another. Yes, these guys are trying to be internally accountable to one another. For example, the Council of Ministers is responsible, to the Lok Sabha, right? Which means the way the Council of Ministers have spent their money is responsible to the Lok Sabha, correct? Yes, or responsible to the Parliament, if you'd like to call it that. Now, you need a specialized body who can very accurately and in a very unbiased manner tell you that, boss, this is how the elected executive has spent their money. For that, you create the CAG, right? Yes, 100%. Sure. Pakka. Great. Now tell me something. Isn't the CAG doing a mini judicial review? They're performing the task of keeping a check on the other branch. So if you are functioning like the judiciary without really being the judiciary, shouldn't you be treated like the judiciary? Supreme Court na hote hue bhi, Supreme Court ke jaisa kaam karne ki koshish kar rahe ho aap? Yes. Isn't the CAG removed in the same manner as that of the Supreme Court judge? Yes. Isn't the CAG removed in the exact same manner as that of the Supreme Court judge? Correct? Yes. This is why. Absolutely. Exactly, Devanshu. Performing rule number 4 so as to avoid the limitations of rule number 2. समझ में आया, क्लियर हुआ? मतलब अगर इसको मैं एक इक्वेशन से दिखाऊं आपको, इंडियाज हाईएस्ट जुडिशियल बॉडी इज द सुप्रीम कोर्ट, इंडियाज हाईएस्ट क्वाजाई जुडिशियल बॉडीज आर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल बॉडीज, कंपेयर इक्वेशन वन एंड इक्वेशन टू, इंडिया हाईएस्ट हाईएस्ट, बिटवीन क्वाजाई जुडिशियल एंड जुडिशियल देयर इज एटलीस्ट हाफ जुडिशियल, सुप्रीम कोर्ट एंड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल बॉडी, यस, सो दोज कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल बॉडीज विच आर ट्रूली परफॉर्मिंग अ क्वाजाई जुडिशियल फंक्शन, यस, विल बी रिमूव्ड इन द सेम मैनर एज दैट ऑफ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट. So is the CAG a quasi-judicial body? Yes, absolutely. ठीक है, समझ में आया? Clear? पक्का? It's that simple. So what I'm going to do is, in just three tables, when I give you the notes tomorrow, in just three tables, I'm going to put all of it down in just three tables, in just three lines, and you just have to memorize them. It's based on the same principles, and I will give you the tricks in those principles itself, and you will not have any problems at all memorizing it. Clear? Understood this? Yes? Sure? Pakka? Great. Perfect. And that is how your bodies would be done. Like, for example, in a GST council, you require a 3/4 majority for all decisions that have to be taken on behalf of center and states. Why? Because minimum 2/3 is for all federal decisions. Add a little bit more, 3/4. That is why. Clear? Understood this? Sure? That is why. Okay? Great. So I'll put all the tables in one place. On this note, I thank you so much for all your patience. The reading list, the notes, will be given to you in a day. I must thank you, and I must also thank Dora. Say hi. She has been a wonderful companion. Wo dekho, wo so rahi hai udhar. So she sits in all the classes very quietly. She is the most learned person in the country. So yeah, see you guys. Bye bye. Thank you. And I will see you guys very, very soon. This is an Indian, it is an indie adopted dog. Hum kapdon mein brand dhoond lete hain, kutton mein nahi dhoondte hain. Kutton mein hamari jaan basti hai, unme brand nahi dekha jata. Theek hai? Yes, okay. So I'll give you a table, okay? And those tables will cover everything in one place. Theek hai? All right. So thank you, and I'll see you guys. Bye bye.